G'day YouTubers, Pirate Pete here, coming from Sydney to talk about our favourite topic once again, gold and silver. So hopefully everyone's had a very safe and happy holiday period. I think I've seen a few videos, some of you have already shared some of the little treasures you've picked up for Christmas, which looked pretty cool and made me jealous, but really exciting to watch. But in this video here, I wanted to get into a topic, I think, in response to some videos I've watched, not so much from the stacking community, but just more generally. I see a lot of discussion around whether now is a great time to buy gold, is it a good price, that sort of thing. So I thought what I'd do is chime in with my 2 cents worth, share with you my approach for valuing gold. So it's a data-driven approach. It's one that involves analysing a lot of observable data, running it through a mathematical model, and coming up with some kind of statistical interpreted observational conclusion from that. So it's very dry. It is deliberately so. I think it's very easy to get emotional about your investments, especially if large dollars are involved. So having some kind of mechanical process that's kind of dry and boring is actually a pretty helpful thing, just to avoid some of the weaknesses in the human spirit when we get into making purchasing decisions around gold. So although the topic's pretty boring and dry, I've tried to keep it as punchy as I can, just so that you can tolerate this video and bear with me as I go through it all. So I'll jump straight in. So it's basically a four-step valuation approach. What I'm doing is I'm starting off with some kind of idea or theory about what might be driving the price of gold. So you read the news, you watch the news, you listen to other people talk, you have debates. And from that, you kind of get a sense of what you think might be driving the price of gold today. Well, that's where step one comes from. Step two is, now I want to get some data to test some of these theories. So what sort of data do I need? Where will I find it? That's all covered in step two. Step three is where I run the analysis, running it through some statistics and working out what the strength of the relationships are between the variables that we've downloaded our data for. And step four is then interpreting the results. One of the things I've found here is that with analysis, it never ends. You reach your interpretations and results in step four, but really what it does is it opens up more questions. So then you go back to step one and start all over again as you dive a bit deeper into a particular area. But what I'm doing in this video is walking you through each of those four steps to give you a bit of an example of it, and hopefully it's of use to you, or you have some other ideas. But one thing to bear in mind, when I'm talking about the valuation of gold, I'm not talking about the price of gold. We can just very easily look at a price chart to see what the price of gold is. The valuation is what we think it's worth. So in Warren Buffett's terms, to pinch his quote, price is what you pay and value is what you get. So what I'm really looking for is a way of estimating the value of gold so that I can work out whether the price is at fair value or not. Okay, so here in step one, the idea generation step, I just want to come up with a few ideas on what I think could be influencing gold. So the ideas that come to my mind, the strength of the US dollar, US inflation, the size of US federal debt, the amount of money printing that central banks have been doing, and whether that's had any bearing on total US money supply and whether that has a relationship to gold. And finally, emerging market economic development. So places like China, India, Brazil, Russia, the emerging markets or emerging economies, whether their growth and demand for gold has been driving any effect on the gold price. So I want to test these out. Alrighty, so in step two, we want to get the most appropriate data to test out some of our ideas from step one. So given the dot points we had in step one, the sort of data I'll be looking for is gold price data, US dollar trade weighted index data. So that's basically a relative measure of the US dollar versus other currencies over time. US inflation data, US federal debt, or level of US debt, federal debt over time. This US M2 stock and M2 velocity, it's basically money supply. So money supply is a bit of a tricky one. It's something that I've seen, I think, a lot of people get wrong. They don't differentiate between supply versus stock. So I'll get into that when we look at that data a bit more a little later on. And I'm going to look at Indian GDP. So for the one where we're talking about emerging markets, I'm specifically going to have a look at Indian GDP and its relationship to gold. Okay, so step three for the analysis, all of those ideas from step one are being tested, and they're all going to be represented as a chart. So what I'll do is I'll spend a little bit of time explaining here this first chart, and that way you'll understand the pattern for each chart that we look at in the subsequent pages. So what I've got in this particular example is gold versus the trade weighted index of the US dollar. So I'm trying to test the relationship between the price of gold and the relative strength of the US dollar versus other currencies that the US trade with. And it's 40 years of data, so 1975 to present is 40 years worth of data that I'm going to be examining here on this chart. And all of the gold prices are expressed in 2015 dollars. So it just basically means that I've taken inflation out of all my data, and I'm just comparing like with like. So on the chart itself, what I've got is an XY axis where gold is running along the horizontal axis or the X axis, and I've got the trade weighted index values plotted on the Y axis. So when I take those two data sets and I plot them on this graph, or Excel plots it on this graph, what I've got is all those blue dots everywhere that represents each piece of data or each observation from my data set. And what I've got is a black line that is sort of sloping downhill, and that represents a line of best fit for all my data. So you'll see in black an equation there that says y equals negative 8.8158 x plus 1632.9. So in simple terms, what that's saying is that the value of the trade weighted index, so the y-axis, is equal to those numbers times by a given value of gold, and then just add 1632.9 to that number, and you end up with this dot. So that there is effectively the linear equation of that black line, and the R squared equals 0.11484. That's a measure of the relationship, or the strength of the relationship, between these two observation points. So a score that's closer to one means that it's highly or very highly correlated. If that red number actually equaled 1.0, it would be a perfect correlation between the two variables. And if it's closer to zero, it means it's a weak correlation. So a score of 0.11 is closer to zero than it is to one. It's a very weak correlation for that 40-year history of data. Okay, so if I have a look at this next slide here, it's examining the same variables, gold versus the trade weighted index. But this time it's comparing the data between 1975 and 1989. So basically it's looking at the history from when the gold standard had ended and we moved into a fiat-based system from 75 onwards. And it goes up right up until, I guess, the end of communism, until communism fell. So again, same axis plots. same black line showing line of best fit, another different type of equation. Well, it's the same linear equation, just with different numbers now based on this data, and we come up with a different R squared score, or a correlation coefficient. So that correlation there of 0.05 shows that it's very weak. So I wouldn't really spend too much longer looking at this particular chart. So I'll go on to the next chart. This time I'm looking at gold versus the trade weighted index, and I'm looking at it between the years 1990 and 2008. So I've picked the time series between where communism had failed, or we'd entered a new global economic kind of relationship that wasn't so much East and West anymore. It was very much moving into this free trade world that we now live in. But I've taken it up until 2008, because that's when we had a GFC, and I kind of think that things have changed with central bank printing post 2008. So I've picked this particular period of time to have a look at it specifically, and I can see this time I get an R squared scored, a score of 0.71. So in that particular period of time between 1990 and 2008, we had what's a pretty strong relationship between gold and the relative strength of the US dollar. Okay, so I put this one basically in my memory bank because that's a significant score, and it's one that's worth exploring a little bit more later on. Now on this next slide here, we're looking at the time period again for the same two variables, gold and the trade weighted index of the US dollar, and this time I'm looking at it from 2008 to present. So not as strong a link, or not as strong a relationship between those two variables in the last 7 years. This time we've got an R squared score of 0.388. So that's a weak to moderate relationship. But I still keep this one in my memory banks because I think that score from 1990 to 2008 was pretty significant, and it's something that I'd be wanting to measure this going forwards for that reason. I just want to see if we end up with a strong link again. All right, so in the next analysis, I'm looking at now the second dot point from step one. This time I'm looking at gold versus the inflation rate. So I'm looking again at a 40-year history initially to begin with, and I come up with a score, an R squared score of 0.04, so very weak relationship there. Over to the next slide, gold versus the inflation rate between the years 1975 and 1989. And this time I get an R squared score of 0.31, so a stronger relationship in that time period. Okay, over to the next slide, between the periods 1990 to 2008, it's a weak score, 0.22. Looking at the next slide, which is 2008 to present, and I see a more stronger relationship there, 0.55. That's sort of showing it's a moderate relationship between the two variables, so I'll keep that one in my memory banks as well. Nothing really super strong in terms of the relationships, but those two are pretty strong. Alrighty, now I want to test out the third dot point, which was gold versus US federal debt. So here I've got 1975 to present, so 40 years of data, and I've got an R squared score of 0.15, so a pretty weak relationship between gold and the level of federal debt over that time frame. So on the next slide, 1975 to 1989, I've got an even lower score, 0.02, so very weak relationship there. Over to the next slide, 0.14, again a very low number, a weak relationship in that time frame. And on the last slide for that analysis, 0.03. So having a look at it through four different sets of time series, I've got a very weak relationship between the gold price and the total amount of US federal debt. So don't know if that surprises anyone, but maybe different set of data or different type of measure of debt might be needed before I conclude fully, but at face value, doesn't look like the level of federal debt is having too much influence on the price of gold in the last 40 years. Okay, so then fourth dot point to measure, which was gold versus money supply. Now, I just wanted to talk about what money supply is, how it's measured, and where I think a lot of people get it wrong, at least where I've been watching a lot of YouTube videos on this. I think they're getting themselves a bit mixed up on this. So if I take a step back and say, well, what actually is money supply? There's no easy sort of answer to this, but it's basically all the money that is immediately available. Let's just put it that way. So whether it's notes and coins, or whether it's, you know, very, very short term deposit type accounts. So could be a check account, could be a transaction account like your debit cards that you use, or it could be very short term term deposits, that sort of thing. But basically, it's something that's very liquid and can be used as cash in a very short space of time. So there's a whole bunch of different ways that money supply is measured. You may have heard different terms used with respects to money supply. So things like M1, M2, M3, base money, broad money, all that kind of stuff. But look, it all just means the same thing. Now, where I think a lot of people get it wrong is that there's a difference between money supply and money stock. So money stock is like the total dollar value of all those items I just talked about. So the total dollar value of all your bank accounts and notes and coins and all of that sort of stuff, that's money stock. Money supply is worked out when you multiply money stock by something that's called the velocity of money. And the velocity of money is basically how many times that money changes hands in a given period of time, usually a year. So if I have $10 and I spend $10 and I bought myself some lunch, okay, whoever sold me that has my $10, or it's theirs now, they can then use it to buy something. Maybe they pay their bills. So then they spend that $10. Now, in terms of velocity of money, that $10 is stock, money stock. And it changed my hands, it changed that person's hands twice. So the velocity of money would be 2. So you would just go money stock, which was $10, multiplied by velocity, which was 2, equals money supply, which would be 20 in that really simple example. So in an economy, it's the total amount of money stock multiplied by the velocity of money, and that equals your money supply. Now, where I think a lot of commentators are talking about central banks are printing all this money and it's going to cause all this inflation. Look, it may not. I don't really have a conclusion to talk about in this video on that particular thing. But all I'm saying is that all the central bank money printing that's been going on has added to money stock. But what's been happening is that the velocity of money has been falling since 2008. And that's why we haven't yet seen this inflation. So even though money stock has grown a lot with all the quantitative easing or money printing that's been going on, without that money changing hands, it's not going through the economy and causing inflation. And the big reason for that, I might cover in another video, but just understand the difference between money stock and money supply. Okay, money supply is the money stock times the velocity of money. All right, so now get back to this chart where I look at gold versus money supply. I really was expecting a higher correlation here between the two variables, and I haven't seen it in this data. So in the last 40 years, a score of 0.02. It's just almost no relationship there. And it gets worse between the years 1975 and 1989. You can see the relationship there in red, 0.0064. And between the years 1990 and 2008, where it's only 0.02. And then in the most recent observations between 2008 and present. So I just can't see through this data any relationship between gold and money supply, at least not US money supply. So something that I'll keep looking at going forwards, but I couldn't see any relationship in it in the last 40 years. All right, so covering off now the final dot point, which was emerging markets and gold. I've picked India as an example of an emerging market. And what I've done is I've compared the gold price with India's GDP. Now, I didn't have 40 years of data here. I could only get it as far back as 1990. So between 1990 and 2008, there is a very high relationship between gold and India's economic development. So a score of 0.73 over that time frame shows a very high relationship, a high correlation between the two variables. And in the most recent, it's just dropped off. So between 2008 and present, there's very little relationship between gold and India's GDP. So I was a bit surprised by that drop off. So I'm not 100% convinced that the data is good quality, and I think that might be influencing the results that I'm seeing there. So I'm reserving judgment on that one. I'm going to have to look for some other data sources, I think, but where one looked extremely strongly related and then the second one looked very sort of like it's not related at all. I'm a bit skeptical about that. So I'm going to have a look at some other emerging markets and see if I can't find some better data for those. But I still think it's worth exploring a bit more. Alrighty, so that brings me now to step four, which is the conclusion. So I found the strongest correlations existed in the first two tests that I ran. So the US US trade weighted index versus gold and US inflation versus gold. I found the weakest correlations between gold and the US federal debt, as well as gold and US money supply. I'm calling inconclusive gold versus India GDP because I had one observation there that was very strong in terms of the relationship or the correlation, and I had one observation which was very weak. So I'm reserving judgment on that, calling it inconclusive. I want to retest that, maybe using some other data, maybe using even different emerging markets. But they're the, I guess, the data-driven conclusions that I come from that analysis. Some general observations. I think what I've noticed is that correlations over a particular test does change over time. So I did see, for example, some instances where what over 40 years looked like there was no relationship, suddenly stronger relationships emerged when I zoomed in on a particular time frame within that 40-year history, and vice versa. So correlations do change over time, and therefore it's worth to continually retest over time. So if you do take a data-driven approach to valuing an asset, it is worth retesting over time because those correlations do change over time. Alrighty, so to wrap it up here on this last slide, what I did was I took the two strongest correlated variables, that was the trade-weighted index and the inflation rate, and I put them in the same equation and ran it with the price of gold. So the line of best fit gave me this particular equation, gold equals 751.78 minus 31.84 times the trade-weighted index value plus 13.68 times the CPI value. So that linear equation, if you just plug in certain numbers for TWI and CPI, you'll come up with an expected value of gold with a given R square, so 0.56 or approximately 57% confident that a dollar move in gold is explained by that particular equation. So that's what the statistics means. The standard error, 106.94, just means that whatever value for gold you come up with, you've got to give or take $106. That's how big the margin of error of this particular model is. So if we, for example, use the most recent numbers for the trade weighted index and for the CPI. So bear in mind, these are index numbers. They're not percentage numbers. So a CPI of 238 doesn't mean inflation is running at 238%. It's just a point in time index number. So if we plug in these numbers into that equation up there, we come up with approximately a value of $990 an ounce, give or take our margin of error of $106. So today, I think gold is roughly $1,060 an ounce. So this particular valuation model is there with that margin of error included. It just basically means that today the gold price is at the upper end of this particular model's valuation for gold. So it's not perfect, because there's a lot more work that needs to be done with different sets of data and maybe finding more strongly related data sets. But this particular example, running those numbers, the analysis would spit out this sort of conclusion. So very dry, mechanical sort of a process, very unemotive process, but that is what I'm looking for when it comes to valuing an asset. I don't really want emotions to guide my judgment on the value of something. That concludes this video. Let me know in the comment section below any feedback, if you have any other ideas on what you think might be driving the price of gold today. I'll see if I can't find data for that and do some sort of regression tests on that as well. But I'm going to do a lot more analysis. There's, like I said at the start of this video, there's probably more questions than answers that comes from this process, and I've got a lot more analysis paralysis to get through before I've got real concrete conclusive statements to make around the value of gold. But this here is just to give you a bit of an example on the overall method and approach that I take when it comes to valuing something. And I'll catch you all on the next video. All right, take care. Cheers. Now, if you like this video and you'd like to see more just like it, why don't you show your support by joining the crew, and we'll explore gold and silver together.